books on our association. Sok will come after this session, and they will be at your disposal. And the second information concerns the travel costs. If somebody hasn't settled the travel costs, it's an opportunity to do it after this session in my colleague Standa. And now I would like to present the panel which follows up to the morning panel. These two panels are both devoted to the issue official politics of memory before 1989. And we will hear two contributions. First will be delivered by Ondřej Daniel. It will be the contribution entitled Comrades. The Comrades are right. History of movement on the screens of late socialist television. I would like to present Ondřej Daniel shortly. He works at the Faculty of Arts at Charles University, and he deals with many topics such as post-socialism, nationalism, migration, popular culture. And he succeeded in publishing book Rock or Turbo Folk, The Imagination of Migrants from the Former Yugoslavia. Please, it's
thank you very much, Michal, for that, for this extensive presentation of myself. I will be more modest, but thank you to all organizers, panelists, participants, everybody for the possibility I can be speaking here. I'm actually coming from the Center of Study for Study of Popular Culture, which is a similar association like SOC or Social Circle. It is in many respects collaborating with SOC, and it is a non-profit organization who is which is interested in the topics of popular culture as an, let's say, important factor of social imagination and also politics. So I'll be speaking about late socialist television series and their way how they presented the movement, let's say the workers' movement of the 1920s, 1930s as a connection to the Communist Party of Czechoslovakia. The expressive saying in the title of the presentation, "Comrades, the comrades are right," comes from the 1986 series, the first part of the series called Gottwald, which is devoted to the life story of the first so-called workers' president, or the first communist president of Czechoslovakia. And it's taken from, as we see, for the 47th minutes of the first part, one delegate of the regional branch of a party meeting in 1929, which is an important date for the Bolshevization of the Czechoslovak party, Czechoslovak Communist Party. And it has been taken also, it's also like, how to say, interesting to note that this statement was delivered in a, let's say, in a Moravian dialect in order to keep really the touch of the working grassroots movements. So this delegate said, "Workers, please listen to the comrades, because the comrades are right." So this is basically it. And as Michal has mentioned, I was more or less until the end of my dissertation interested for the topics in the topics connected with the former Yugoslavia. After that, I switched to former Czechoslovakia. I did his study on Leibold, which is an important livre de memoir for the Croatian far right, so the political memory of the nationalist in Greece, which is in a way related to what I will be speaking about now. Also, you can see where I'm coming from let's say the studies of popular culture, nationalism, more regionalism, more in this way. This I will be also making reference to that. In 2013, we have presented a study with a colleague of mine, Jan Lomicek, on two series, one from 1988 and one from 1997, and tried to analyze them politically and to make a comparative perspective on how the ideology of the late state socialist regime and the post-socialist regime is to be manifested in these two series. One of them was the natives, which is one of the series I will be speaking about today, and the second one was the Feral County, which is also dealing with the post-war years and the 1950s. Also, lately, I try to analyze another 1995 TV series. As a Bildungsroman, I put here, of a post-socialist bourgeoisie, which is the most interesting part from for you and me, an analysis of the internal or the imagination of this series, which is fascinated by the aristocracy, which I was struck with the lecture of the keynote speaker today, who was speaking about intelligentsia fascinated by the aristocracy, so I found this thing in the series of the 1990s also. The present paper is an inverse part of the same coin, so it is not dealing with the commercial culture, but more with the official culture. And I would like to understand or dig into the connection between popular culture, official culture, and historical memory. So enough to speak about big words. I will be, both of the series which I will mention are connected with the person of the screenwriter. You can see him on the right. His name was Jaroslav Matejka. He was a communist militant from the Brno region and living in 1927-2010. And both of these series are covering the period 1927 until 1921 until 1948. So it's interwar period, anti-Nazi resistance, and post-war seizure of power by the Communist Party. Because it's quite an extensive period, I will try to focus only on the 1929, the topic I already mentioned, on the Bolshevization of the Communist Party of Czechoslovakia. And I will try to find out what meanings related to the connection of the regime, of the bureaucratic regime with the workers' movement are to be found in this TV series. And I will try to react on a statement of one of the, left-wing intellectuals now present in the Czech media space, Martin Škabra, who speaks about the late state socialism as a period or as a regime, ideological regime, cycled in the references to itself. So I'll try to look into this, if this is possible. And I will try to, also deploy another contemporary leftist theoreticians of the Czech civic left, non-class left in a way, Michal Pullman. My work is also echo to Boris Buden and his, the work of the end of post-socialism and the quest to come or to rethink the left-wing foundations of the state socialist regimes. And speaking about the party, the movement, and the class, I will be doing the echo to the Marxist autonomist theory, especially the workerism. Authors like Sergio Bologna, who state that the political struggles are the results of the actual material conditions of the class. So back to the series. The first one was the 1988 Rodaci, the natives. It's centered about the life story of the, you can see the violin player here. It's a young communist militant from the region of Brno, south eastern Czech Republic, and there is a very important local dimension again. Speaking about, let's say, the interconnectedness of the Communist Party with the workers' movement. It is based in the imaginary town, small town of Radeč, but they also came from Ivančice, which is in the picture, it's a very small, small town in the Brno region. Which is closely linked to its countryside bases, which is dominated by the vineyards, stereotypically also, and they are working with these stereotypes quite extensively, but also with the coal mining region of Rosice and Oslavany, with an important left-wing tradition and the workers' movement. The second series is from 1986, Gottwald, I mentioned already. And it's focusing on the political career of Klement Gottwald as a general secretary of the Czechoslovak Communist Party, and it speaks, it shows also strikes of the 1920s, 1930s, but also, and more importantly, political intrigues in parliament, in party, in trade unions, etc. So it gives more an idea about official version of the party history, and in particular the intra-party power relations, and much less about the locality. We know that Gottwald also came from this more or less the same region like Matejka, but it's not mentioned almost in any way, and only by using some dialectical motifs also, but they are the dialects that come from somewhere completely else, so it's just complete nonsense. And if there is any locality, it is more Prague Žižkov, and it's important left-wing, let's say, tradition. Not only communist, but social democrat and anarchist also, and all the working class suburbs of Karlin and Libeň. So let's say the more urban part of the story. In both idea, in both series, we have to do with young, devoted, idealist, militant. And in both stories, we have to do with kind of a hagiography and a multilogy, because in speaking with the reference to the first one you see on the left, it's not Gottwald, but because he was already during this 1920s, he was already in his 40s, so there is a young devoted militant. So-called Vašek Horáček, and he's really like following him very closely. And the second one from the natives is Petr Vitásek, and there's an important thing with Vitásek, also in the series, there is an important romantic movement, the romantic involvement of Vitásek. And this is the romantic involvement. There are only some of the pictures I found on the internet, because generally he's through the series, we come to this, he has about six or seven girlfriends, so I only found three. And important recurring motifs in both series, there is a political violence, which it's manifested in the clashes with the far-right opponents or the intra-party violence or with the police. Here, I would like to follow historian Michal Kulman, who speaks about the Czechoslovak late state socialism as a kind of a non-violent ideal trying to force out any mentions of the violence. And it is true that most of the violence we see in these two series are in a way non-violent, because it's due to the bad acting of the actors, or it is just more than theater play. It is funny, and it's more kind of a part of this kind of bucolic myth of the Czech national tradition. Anyway, I don't want to neglect any actual victims of the police violence against the strikes or against the working class manifestations in the 1920s, but in these two series they look more or less funny. About the party, so coming the idea coming from the first series of Gottwald, the party is a result of let's say pragmatic power plays. When they are speaking about 1929 Bolshevization, it is let's see, in idealist vision they speak about the committees on workplaces, and Gottwald poses himself against the intellectuals who tend to direct the whole working class, and in a way he's opposing the Leninist idea, and in a way approaching let's say council communism or another Bolshevik parts of the communism, but anyway unifying the party under his let's say clique. Especially following the centralizing role of the Comintern and dealing with internal opposition with the reformists, socialists, and the external opposition, and the party as a result of this pragmatic power plays is centralized and highly hierarchized. In natives, we can see, which is on the left, we can see much more an idealist vision. There is also this like power plays I mentioned, but the party is also a result of the grassroots committees, which verbally is also in Gottwald, but it is shown only in natives. And the connection to the vertically organized bureaucratic apparatus with the important regional committee in Brno, but also the central committee in Prague, is somehow minimized with putting emphasis on the importance of a small day-to-day diligent militant work on all levels. So the party in both ideas, is the basis of. On the class, the other way around. The class is the only basis of the party. In Gottwald, in the first theory, we there are only industrial proletarians mentioned, but this we can only guess because there is no actual proof of their actual workplaces, because we only see the political meetings of the workers, but no, they are not working basically. So this is it. In natives, it is more nuanced picture. Besides the industrial proletarians, also you can find some connotations with the petty bourgeoisie and with the agriculture workers, and it is more kind of an encompassing vision. If we come back to the movement, which is like the central point of this presentation. So in both series, it is practically channeled only through the party. There is no place for any autonomous or out-of-party revolutionary activities. The party comes from the movement, and it is without, any reference to actual reason or to why the people start these strikes. So there is no expression of. Like frustration of the material, social, economic frustrations of the everyday life. So the struggles are somehow shown in this timeless void without any connotation to what comes before and what comes after. So coming back to this original hypothesis about the self-referencing teleology, I have to admit that at least through these two series, it is true that the production of the official culture did really only show the messages to itself. And I come to conclusions. Both of the series, there was a bad timing of their showing in the late 1980s, because they really didn't gain almost any popularity among the Czechoslovak television audience, especially because simultaneously the television audience started to be open towards the global culture and the global cultural trends. Only some limited spectators' popularity it gains through the exotization of the region with all this wine tasting, wine partying, violin, and so on. and through the romance, because the, one of these two key actors really was involved in many romantic relationships, so at least he was sympathetic to the viewers in some way. I have to think that one of these series were probably presented to counterbalance the reformist cultural production in the context of perestroika, which similarly to, for example, Soviet Union, in the late 1980s in Czechoslovak TV or more in cinemas, we can already find some more sociologically interested, often exploitation movies in Russian, giving this name Chernucha, with some connections to the already born mafia and so on. But this is something completely different canon of this thing. And there's also one thing which I try to put, especially within these two pictures, the state socialist regime emphasized the relation with the history of the movement and try to present the communist officials as normal people, so as normal Czechs. And we can see that on one picture they are sitting in the committee in these gray suits, and in the second they are doing this DIY barbecue like any other Czech during the weekend on this family house. So thank you very much. I will say like this, like Comrade Lutwald here, it's my expressions of gratitude to be here, and thank you.
Thank you for your comprehensive contribution, and I would like to ask Maria to change places with Ondřej. And I would like to say that Ugné Marija Andrijauskaité is a PhD student of Vytautas Magnus University, Kaunas, Lithuania. She works on her thesis called Urban Workers and the Organized Labor Movement in Lithuania between 1918 and 1940. Her research field comprises the 20th century Lithuanian historian, social historian, historical anthropology, and it's worth of mentioning her concern in non-communist radical left thought and organizations in interwar Lithuania. So please.
Thank you for presenting me. So I'd like to start my presentation with some unexpected context, which would maybe help to tell the story, which happened after my thesis for this conference was already submitted. And these are rather some fresh headlines and comments from Lithuanian media related to labor movement activities. Activists who traveled to Russia, where they participated in the educational program and a big demonstration of labor unions in Vilnius this September. So those two events and how they were pictured in the media shows us that Lithuanian people did not come into the peace with the past, and that the labor unions are still seen as a Moscow's tool to take over Lithuania. I would like to argue that this perception of unionism is related with the history of workers' movement in Lithuania, which was written only during the years of Soviet occupation. I would like to briefly present the historical context, and if someone is interested in that, please ask me after the presentation or during the breaks, because it's a totally different story. And the communist ideas reached Lithuania, at the time part of the Russian Empire, in the late 19th century. And the first Lithuanian communist organizations were found in the spring of 1918. That is already after the declaration of independence in the 16th of February 1918. And since the newly created state was not functioning yet, so in some parts of Lithuania, the communists declared the Soviet Republic of Lithuania on 16th of December of 1918. However, this kind of revolt was defeated and at the end of the summer of 1919, and the Communist Party moved to carry most of their activities underground. However, in 1922, the Communist Party participated in the elections for the parliament under the name Workers' Company, when they got 5 mandates out of 90. The parliament was released off duty in 1923, and it was the first and the only Lithuanian parliament with a communist in it before the occupation. Of course, after the occupation in 1940, the Communist Party of Lithuania began the incorporation of Lithuania into the Soviet system. One of important fields of work was the creation of a new course of history. And the history had to be used as a tool to explain the events of the summer of 1914. And the best way to do this is to present the events from 1918 to 1940 as a teleological course of history. Of course, it is necessary to keep in mind that the historians were not free to choose their approach on the topic, and it's doubtful that such a narrative of the history of the Lithuanian Communist Party, LKP, was created with a free will. However, there were several serious problems to create such a narrative. First, the communists were not a very popular political party until 1935, and they did not have much influence neither in the country neither in the labor movement itself. Second, the party presented itself as the one and only truly workers' party, but Lithuania was a country with almost no heavy industry, small cities, and the biggest part of its population was living in rural areas and living off land, which did not exactly fit into the picture and did not correspond with most of the ideas of the Russian Communist Party. Third, in the early years, the LKP has very little to do with the workers themselves. It was yet unclear what should be the position of the party regarding the labor movement and labor unions. The leaders of the Communist Party, the Lithuanian Communist Party, did not share a similar background with the workers, since most of them were born in rich families, got university education, and were more concerned with intellectual work than working with the masses. That is why the historians of Soviet Lithuania had a difficult task: how to write a history of Lithuanian Communist Party and overcome these inconveniences. One of the possible solutions was to combine the history of LKP with the history of the Lithuanian labor movement. So I will present the main story points where the history of LKP gets very close to the history of the workers, or even collides and become a similar storyline. History from all science was the most ideologized field of research. However, when it comes to my presentation topic, I was not able to find the history of LKP told as the history of labor movement and the workers in Stalinist or Khrushchev's era Lithuanian historiography. Only Hauser, who was and still isn't famous about his attitude towards writing the Lithuanian history and following the rules imposed by the LKP and Moscow, in 1960 wrote that quote, "Lithuanian working class, from the first days of its formation, acted with a belief that they should go on the same path with the Russian working class, what could lead to the victory." In Brezhnev's era historiography, this point of view is much more common. In 1965, Čepulienė wrote in her brochure Lithuanian Workers Fight for Soviet Government in 1919-1940. Quote, "Lecturer who reads this lecture must show how distressed were Lithuanian laboring men because of the fall of Soviet government in 1919. They did not want to put up with bourgeois regime and fought for the re-establishment of Soviet government in Lithuania, and the fight was led by LKP." long and hard fight of labor men for the Soviet government was led by LKP and ended with the victory of socialist revolution in 1940. 1 year later, Černiauskas' brochure of the workers' movement in Lithuania, 1927-1940, also promoted a similar image of labor unions as the leading force in the fight for the Soviet government. He wrote, "Labor unionism in Lithuania was a part of workers' movement and it had a long and complicated life. This movement is important for laboring man's life. If we study it, we can understand the role of labor unions and workers' organizations in the revolutionary fight better. It also helps to educate the laboring man in a communist way, raise their consciousness, and promote communist relationships." He proposed that in June of 1940, the fascist dictatorship was abolished in Lithuania, and the forward and revolutionary labor unions played a big role in this change. Revolutionary workers' unions, a part of Lithuanian proletariat, helped the Soviet to organize and unite the working class and to reach the final goal, abolish the capitalist system. So this would mean that the laboring men themselves were responsible not only for the abolishment of Antanas Smetona's non-democratic regime, but also for the Soviet rule in Lithuania alongside with the occupation. So as we can see, one of the common recurrents in narrating the history of the Lithuanian Communist Party as a history of the labor movement in Soviet historiography is the usage of the word workers as a synonym for the communists, meaning both the sympathizers and the party members. In the book First, Workers and Peasants Government in Lithuania, Bronis Vitkevičius wrote that in 1918, the labor unions of Vilnius became more active. The workers expected that the German occupation would be over and the Soviet government will gain power. According to the author, the working class was the main executor of the changes in power and the government. Another text by Bronia Čepulienė, a brochure for the labor unions released more than 10 years later in 1978, followed the same narrative. The author wrote that as an outcome of the selfless revolutionary struggle of laboring men on December 16, 1918, Soviet authority was declared in Lithuania. Of course, it was the labor unions led by the communists who were the most important factor in socialist remaking of economy and introducing the Soviet government means into the region. More moderate approach to the relationship between the laboring men and the communist party was that in general, the leader of the workers was the LKP and the other political parties or organizations played a minor role in the labor movement. Sometimes the influence of LKP to the workers was explained in the most unusual ways. For example, in 1967, Lukashevichna wrote a publication about the workers' club in Kaunas, where she stated that one of the communist leaders, professional revolutionary Karolis Požela, became the soul of workers' club even though he had never been there. But mostly the historians tried to find the balance between the preferred and actual role of the Lithuanian Communist Party in the labor movement. It is clearly seen that in the history of Lithuanian Soviet Socialist Republic from 1917 to 1940, which was released in 1965 and was edited by Vigalaitis, Šarmaitis and Žiugžda. As it was written there, the Lithuanian working class, which was led by the Communist Party, always fought for the better workers' life conditions, higher wages, shorter working hours, and better workplace conditions. This was more or less a template for the latter books and the approach of to the labor movement in Lithuania till 1940, when the working class, led by LKP, rose for the new brave fights for the workers, socialist liberation, and freedom of Lithuania. The same was repeated 1 year later and in previously mentioned Černiauskas' brochure. It was written there that, quote, LKP was fighting for the working class and the unity of labor unions. It helped to organize the fight of everyday needs, justice and freedom. That is why workers' unions were close to LKP and supported the party. Most of the claims were based on Kapsuka's writings, who was one of the founders and leaders of LKP, so it was not the most reliable source. And the role of LKP on the labor movement seems to be exaggerated, and the unions were presented only as a tool of LKP. They didn't have any agency themselves. Although it's doubtful whether LKP was the actual leader of the whole labor movement, this kind of approach, however, allowed to broaden the history of labor movement in Lithuania and to introduce new narratives alongside those imposed by the era. In 1988, Vitkevičius wrote that in the summer of 1918, there were 10 unions with 5,000 workers in Vilnius. All of them were organized by region, nationality, or even religion. This happened because of the unique historical context of Lithuania. The communists criticized this decomposition as well as the opportunist and neutral unions, since the unions must fight in order to make the socialist revolution hold. Labor unions must be related to the communist organizations and recognize them as their leader. Only the communist leadership can help the unions to succeed. Even though the specific situation of Lithuanian laboring masses was recognized and presented following the rules, Vitkevičius stated that the first Congress of LKP put a Marxist-Leninist basis and gave internationalist proletarian principles to the Lithuanian labor movement. What left the LKP with the same role as the leader and main organizer of the workers? According to Čepuljena, quote, Lithuanian Communist Party was the only political party which was able not only to keep the labor unions together during the fascist times, but even managed to reorganize them. Moreover, during the Tautininkai times, LKP became a recognized leader of the whole working class. It managed to create a political revolutionary army. Most of the workers followed the Communist Party. The hardest part of historians' work during the Soviet times was to find a way how to conciliate the history of labor movement and the history of LKP, the labor and the workers' history itself, and ideological requirements. For example, the application of Marxist-Leninist approach to the research. Here we can also use a similar comparison to a matrix, which was first made by historian Aurimas Švedas in his dissertation and the book Matricos Novaisvia, Fertility of Matrix, which is likely to be the best attempt to analyze the Soviet historiography and the historians' community of Lithuania so far. However, I would prefer to use another comparison and imagine the Soviet historiography as Star Trek's holodeck. Even the things look and feel real there, it may malfunction from time to time, and you can see the glitches uncovering its original grid. And these glitches would be the last but not least the reoccurring trope in the Soviet historiography regarding the labor movement. It is the mistakes of Communist Party. Sometimes the mistakes were recognized, sometimes they were explained in the most bizarre ways, exposing the nature of Soviet historiography. Since Lithuania's case was different from the industrialized countries and most of the people were farm laborers in rural areas, the common paradigm was harder to adapt for the Soviet historians. Moreover, the attitude of LKP towards the land workers in the early 20th century made the creation of a suitable narrative even more difficult. That is why it is possible to find mea culpa expressed in the pages of Soviet historiography. On the other hand, while some of the Soviet historians admitted the mistakes of LKP, the others tried to play around, and those mistakes, or even made creative deductions, which were not compatible with the facts. Černiauskas was the first to write about the tactical mistakes of LKP in 1966, but his writings received harsh criticism from above. The problem was his approach and claims that, quote, in the beginning, the illegal leftist labor unions were weak strike leaders. They were not ready to lead the economic workers' battles, they did not know how to stand up as the leaders, and could not fight the capital's attack. And that, quote, in general, the unionism in Lithuania, 1935-1940, did not become a massive movement. Even though the economic workers' fight was getting bigger and stronger, the workers were becoming more revolutionary, but the labor unions did not grow. Illegal unions were usually small and operated only inside one factory and company. They were not united altogether and acted independently from one another. What distorted the narrative of LKP being the mighty leader of the workers' movement? As well, Čepuljena also repeated that And she wrote that the labor unions of the rural areas were not cooperating with each another, and their activities were scarce, and only a smart part of the workers were members of labor unions. Others believed that it was not worth of leading economic battle, since the bourgeois government would not improve the workers' conditions anyway. So it's necessary to fight a political battle only and try to reintroduce a solid government. According to Chapulin, even thought the failure of LKP to choose the proper tactic was admitted as a tactical error. Later in the same book, Chapulin proposed that LKP managed to roll the roost up in the union movement, and in general it shows a correct way to fight in order to fulfill the economic, social and political goals of the worker. So on the one hand, the Communist Party is criticized, but on the other hand, the tactic was right. So it is possible to summarize Chapulina's work with two quotes: that LKP was learning to work with the masses and did not always choose the right tactic, and LKP was young and an experienced party, it did not know how to combine legal and illegal activities, or underestimated the necessity of economic fight. At that time, the parties did not understand immediately that the conditions had changed, so they made mistakes and got further from the masses. It is worth noticing that the mistakes of youth and looking for a right path are another popular tropes in Soviet historiography and were common in the autobiographies of communists with an unclear past as a way to explain previous political affiliations. Finding the right path cancelled the mistakes of the past and left the histories as it should be, as well as the events of June 1940 cancelled the mistakes of LKP work within the labor movement before the occupation. The most common approach to the Soviet historiography of 20th century Lithuania is ignorance. Books and articles written about political issues and the Communist Party are rejected as a product of ideology. And I'm not trying to deny this nature of Soviet historiography, but I argue that all the official histories must be properly reviewed. Historians of the young generation, which I mentioned before, made a great research analyzing historians' community in Soviet Lithuania and the courses of history writing. But the critical review of Soviet historiography on Lithuania and LKP between 1917 and 1940 was never made. A new history of LKP, the councils of 1918 and 1919, and the labor movement was never written. That is why these topics are still more or less a mystery, both for professional historians and the public. And it bears lots of negative feelings towards the labor movement and the workers as the enemy of the Lithuanian state. Since this dominant narrative of Lithuanian labor history left unreviewed and unchanged, the specter of communism is haunted in the history of the labor movement and in the today's labor movement itself. Only the revision of Soviet historiography and new research of these topics can sort out the things in the past, present, and the future.
Thank you, Ugne, for shedding light on a rather unknown topic. This is an opportunity to pose questions and commentaries. I'm gonna gather three, and answers come later on. Please.
I heard about the violence during the communist regime. Fortunately or unfortunately, I lived in this period of violence. But what is being said wrongly? It is said that it was part of the communist regime. The proof that it was not I use is that, for God's sake, General Secretary of the Communist Party would not sentence himself to death. somebody else had to do it. And who was it? Police. Secret police. In the 50s, I think it was the center. Unfortunately or fortunately, the similar violence was in the United States during the McCarthyism. Sorry that Mr. Steiner, who has lived, because he is very often coming back to the United States, he would tell me. So, my question is, do you think that we didn't have police state?
That's the first question. The second one, who comes here?
Yeah, first of all, thank you for both of your very interesting presentations. My question is to Ondřej. I have one question. Did I get it right that one of those shows you presented was run during the 1990s? No. Okay. Perhaps you could make that clear. When did this show run and when did it stop to run? Because I think that would be very interesting to know.
And the third one comes from the corner.
I've got a question for Maria. In Poland in late 40s, the biggest historical discussion was whether those early socialists, radical socialist communist groups opted for Polish independence or not, or was it right or wrong? Was this part, so the idea of independent Lithuania, ever present in those publications, in historical publications? Was this topic discussed at all?
In 40s?
Well, all around the communist period, until the 1990s.
Like the communist participants?
There were descriptions of a communist radical leftist group that wanted independent Lithuania.
In my research, I haven't noticed anything similar to that. I don't know why, actually, because, for example, the same Vincas Kapsukas, who was the founder and one of the main leaders of the Lithuanian Communist Party, before joining the Communist Party, he was a very active member of Lithuanian independence movement and the national movement of Lithuania. Of course, if this would be a widely known fact, it would make his biography as a communist revolutionary not that suitable as a leader of the Communist Party. So even though the early communists of Lithuania were active in the national movement and the social movement of the workers as well, this was never a popular topic, or not at all a topic in the communist historiography, if I answered the question.
Under answer.
So I'll come to the two questions. First, about the 1990s, it was another series. It was one of those two mentioned. It was one series called Living on the Chateau, which was something I've done parallelly, but I tried to deploy more or less the similar methodology. These two TV series were shown in the late 1980s, and there was a big discussion when they were they reappeared on the screens in the mid of 2000s. Already is more or less depoliticized in one private TV channel.